S-Chan presents educational video lectures as per the AICTE curriculum. Difficult concepts made easy. Study anywhere, anytime.
Hello students, do you know why effective communication at workplace is important? Communicating effectively at workplace is important so that we can create our own identity, we can communicate effectively, we can have our own place in the organization, we know how to develop interpersonal relationships and so on. Welcome to S-Chand Academy. I'm Dr. Vidushi Bhardwaj. So if you want to explore further into oral communication, please refer to the book by Vikas Publications. Link of the book is given in the description box. Why communication at workplace? That too, effective communication at workplace is mandatory, is essential for all of us. So why do you need to understand this is for a reason? So as students, we need to understand how to communicate effectively at workplace so that we can understand that, you know, we have not to do certain things, which definitely is not a good sign as an effective communicator. So let us first of all understand that what the presentation contains. The presentation will have the definition, theoretical definition of communication, why effective communication skills is important, what are the communication parameters, what are the basic communication types, non-verbal communication, what do you mean by soft skills, and what are the essential soft skills for workplace required for the professional development, what are the advantages, and what is the conclusion out of the presentation. So let us proceed with the definition of the word communication, which means communicare. It has been taken from the Latin word, Latin language communicare, which means to share or to something which is mutually understood, you know, by means of signs or symbols. And communication is a process by which information is exchanged between individuals through a common system of symbols, signs or behavior, according to the Webster's dictionary. Now, effective communication at the workplace is one of the signs of a high performance culture. It shows that I can do well if I can communicate well. Of course, I'll be successful at my workplace also. So it is very important to understand what are the nuances of effective communication here. So basically, there are two types of communications we must understand. The first is verbal and the second is non-verbal. When we say verbal, it includes speaking as well as writing. It's a misconception that verbal is only speaking. So when we have mastered the art of speaking and writing well, we are very good at communicating verbally. And non-verbal communication is all to do with our signs, symbols, our paralinguistic elements, and the tone, pitch, and the rhythm of the voice. So oral communication, we have verbal communication as two types. So oral and written. So writing an email to the boss is a part of our verbal communication. And also a baby crying is a part of verbal communication. Now going further, what you mean by non-verbal communication? Now this is a part of communication which is very, very important to understand. Why? Because it's a part of communication which involves neither written nor spoken words. Still, we communicate a lot non-verbally. So according to Albert Mehrabian model, 7% of meaning in face-to-face situation is derived from word symbols, while 93% of meaning in face-to-face communication is transferred through non-verbal symbols. So you can imagine the kind of importance non-verbal communication has in our day-to-day life. So this is the communication data, of the famous communication data which I was talking about. Impact of non-verbal verbal communication is 7%. Paralinguistic elements is 38%. Paralinguistic elements means our tone, pitch, intonation, inflection, other sounds, the way we speak, and all these things would be included in paralinguistic elements. And facial expressions and body language would denote 55% of the impact on the receiver. So in totality, it's a huge percentage. That means we can understand how much importance this non-verbal communication has in our lives, which we need to learn. So paralanguage, what does it mean? Theoretically speaking, we speak with our vocal organs, but we converse with our entire bodies. Conversation consists of much more than a simple interchange of spoken words. So whatever communication which happens besides spoken words and written words is paralanguage. So taking it further, we can say that non-verbal communication speaks loudly. So our gestures, our posture will tell professionally whether we are confused, professional, cordial, or angry. So we need to be careful about our body gestures, our expressions, so that we do not communicate negatively to the other party. Now, body language includes certain things which is to do with oculesics, kinesics, proximics, haptics, paralinguistic elements, and chronemics. Now, all these things are very important in order to understand how do I improve my non-verbal communication, especially at the workplace, so that I can convey a positive message to my receivers. So whatever communication I am, trying to give to the other person through my face and eyes. So when I'm looking at somebody, I'm angry, I'm frowning, and my eyes, they are wide open, that would be termed under oculesics. Whatever I'm communicating through my posture, whether I'm standing straight or I'm sitting with a slouch, or probably I'm not walking properly, this all would be included under kinesics. Then I also communicate through my the space, proximics is something which is known as the space language. So whatever communication I am trying to give when I am standing very close to the person or standing far apart from the person will be included under territory, which is proximics. And we communicate through touch. A small boy or a child being touched by the mother every morning so that she can wake him up, of course, communicates a lot to the child without even speaking. So this communicating through touch has been termed under haptics. Similarly, tone and sound, we already discussed about the paralinguistic elements. And finally, the way I communicate about myself through my time and the way I keep my time and manage my time would be termed under chronemics. Now, let's move ahead with the fact that yes, communication is both verbal and non-verbal. That is what we have already discussed. Body language very often is involuntary and unintentional. We do not get to know what we are trying to convey is something, which is conveyed in the other way if the body language we are carrying is really negative. It expresses our inner feelings, conflicts, and attitude. But the question is, how to study this language now? So, while studying body language, we should take into consideration, number one, the facial expressions, the hand and leg movements, and even the context and culture one is operating in. Context and culture is very important. I, being an Indian, would definitely do a namaste to somebody I meet for the first time. But if I am in America or in Europe, it's perfectly okay to hug somebody when you meet for the first time. But then if I do the same in India, it would go the other way around. The meaning would be negative in nature. So we have to be very careful about the context and culture one is operating in. And it is important for each one of us to recognize that yes, if I, take care of these nuances and little things in terms of non-verbal communication, I accept the feedback that this is what I conveyed, though it was not the intention, and I adapt myself accordingly, I will be successful in my professional life as well. So let's talk about the facial expressions. The face is said to be the most effective indicator of emotions, and researchers have found 8 basic facial emotions, which is surprise, interest, joy, rage, fear, disgust, shame, and anguish. And they are universally found in all cultures. So an Indian who gets angry is the one who probably will be angry over something. The American will also get angry over something. So that does not mean that I will be happy and somebody belonging to some other country will not be happy in a particular context. So it is universally found in all cultures, but yes, we have to understand the culture first. So let's talk about proxemics. So in day-to-day life, we very often, our attitude is signified by spaces we occupy. So both in relation to others and ourselves. So we stand in particular places, occupy particular chairs, maintain specific distances vis-a-vis specific people. So there are four broad categories of space, and proxemics is a term which has been given to the way we communicate, you know, when we occupy certain spaces in our professional as well as personal lives. So the first is intimate distance, then comes the personal distance, social distancing we all know. Hats off to COVID. We all knew, you know, we have to stand apart from the people we are not sure about, and public distance. So why these, you know, these spaces are important? Because the way we occupy these spaces vis-a-vis other people, that communicates a lot about our personality. So facial expression, this is very interesting to note down. Surprise or astonishment we portray through our raised eyebrows. Then anger, furrowed forehead like this, displeasure, frowning, dislike, of course we turn up the nose, and when we dislike something, extreme shock, we do like this, aggression, eyes wide open and lips tightly closed, some kind of disinterest, eyes downcast, face turned away, I'm not interested, interest, relaxed mouth, some kind of smile will show that I'm interested, and blank face, completely withdrawn, not interested. Now, we were talking about the spaces. Look at this. Now, space or zones, proxemics we talked about, can be classified into four categories. The first is intimate zone, personal zone, social zone, and public zone, as we already discussed. So, going further, intimate zone, only certain people are allowed in this close proximity. And of course, this could be from physical contact to about 6 inches from our body. And we reserve this space for people with whom we are emotionally close, like our own children, our parents, our siblings, and so on. Then we have personal distance. This too is relatively close distance zone. But yes, it involves a certain area one reserves around oneself. It is less in case of informal outgoing people. And it is typically the space within which a person maintains privacy or social intimacy. We maintain this personal distance with our friends, our close relatives, and so on. Now comes the social distance. We maintain with people we interact with, but we don't know very well. For example, a new colleague, an employee, or probably a new person we have met for the first time. Distance is generally between 4 to 7 feet. And of course, when we are working in an organization, we take care of the hierarchy, we take care of the relationship we have with our other colleagues, and that is how we maintain social distance within the workplace. And then comes the public distance. So this is the distance between 12 to 25 feet, generally speaking, suitable for lectures or conferences, even when there is a leader or somebody addressing the huge audience from the stage, it would be termed under public distance. And it is something which is maintained at the social level, most importantly when there is a politician or somebody, some actor is addressing people from the stage. So why do we need to understand these spaces? Because in the workplace, at times, may be occupying certain space unintentionally, where the message which the other person will take, can be wrong. So I have to be careful about my space, and that is how it would give a message to the other party that yes, I am very careful, I am very professional, and I am giving a positive message to the receiver. So we have to understand that. Professionally speaking, we have to remember that we are dealing with people. When we are dealing with people, it's all about the body language we have to be careful about, our postures, our eye contact, our orientation, presentation, looks, and expressions of emotions. You know, they are all very important. We also need to understand that yes, our palm positions, give a lot of message to the other person about our personality. Now this, the first position is submissive palm position, where I am ready to submit to the will of others, and this kind of palm position will show what kind of a personality I am. Dominant palm position, of course, showing dominance, and aggressive palm position when I am trying to point out at others. Similarly, the hand shakings will also tell a lot about our personality. Now this kind of handshake, look at the position, it shows dominance. The second kind is giving the control to the first person, that shows submissive nature. And the third one, of course, shows equality, and that is how, you know, you say you shake like a man. That means both of them are equally important. Look at the palm position, the handshakings here. So when these three handshakings we take care of, we can definitely tell about the personality of the people involved in handshakings, and we can also be careful about what are we trying to, you know, tell the other person about our personality. Now, talking about the handshakes further, look at this now. There are other handshakes also. The first is dead fish shaking. So it seems as if we are shaking hands with a dead fish. There is no energy. It's very laid back kind of a shake hand. The second one is the glove. So you see this forms like a glove, and it's something which the politicians maintain when they are shaking their hands. And the third one is dominant, the knuckle grinder, where we are trying to dominate the other person. So with this, we are coming to the end of the part one of the communication at workplace presentation. In this presentation, what are the key takeaways? The key takeaways are effective communication at workplace. Why do we need them? How do we achieve them? What are verbal and non-verbal communication? What is the difference between both, and how do we achieve especially mastery over the non-verbal communication, including the paralinguistic elements? We talked about kinesics, proxemics, and we talked about other non-verbal communication aspects also. So if you want to explore further into oral communication, please refer to the book by Vikas Publications. Link of the book is given in the description box. If you like the video, please like, share and subscribe, and press the bell icon for future updates. Thank you.
All rights reserved. This video has been prepared for educational purposes only. No part of it may be reproduced or copied without the permission of the copyright holder.